Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Different Flesh by Harry Turtledove, narrated by Paul Woodson. 1610. Vilest beast. Simia quam similis, turpissima bestia nobis. The ape, vilest beast, how like us. Ennius quoted in Cicero, De Natura Deorum. Europeans found the New World a very different land from the one they had left. No people came down to the seashore to greet their ships. Before the arrival of European settlers, there were no people in North or South America. The most nearly human creatures present in the America were Sims. In the Old World, Sims have been extinct for hundreds of thousands of years. Fossils of creatures very much like present-day Sims have been found in East Africa, on the island of Java, and in caves not far from Pekin, China. Sims must have crossed a land bridge from Asia to North America during an early glacial period of the Ice Age, when the sea level was much lower than it is now. At the time when humans discovered the New World, small hunting and gathering bands of Sims lived throughout North and South America. Their lives were more primitive than those of any human beings, for they knew how to make only the most basic stone and wood tools, and were not even able to make fire for themselves, although they could use and maintain it if they found it. Paradoxically, this very primitiveness makes them interesting to anthropologists, who see in them an illustration of how humanity's ancient ancestors must have lived. Despite their lack of weapons, more formidable than chipped stones and sticks with fire-hardened points, Sims often proved dangerous to colonists in the early days of European settlement of the New World. As they learned to cope with attacks from bands of Sims, the settlers also had to learn new farming techniques needed for soils and climates different from those of their native lands. Hunger was their constant companion in the early years of the colonies. Another reason for this was the necessity of bringing all seed grain across the Atlantic until surpluses could be built up. The Americas offered no native equivalent of wheat, rye, or barley for settlers to use. Sims, of course, knew nothing of agriculture. Nevertheless, the Spaniards and Portuguese succeeded in establishing colonies in Central and South America during the 16th century. The first English settlement in what is now the Federated Commonwealths was at Jamestown, Virginia, in 1607. From The Story of the Federated Commonwealths by Ernest Simpson, reproduced by permission. After 30 mild English summers, July in Virginia smote Edward Wingfield like a blast from hell. Sweat poured off him as he tramped through the forest a few miles from Jamestown in search of game. It clung greasily in the humid heat. He held his crossbow cocked and ready. He also carried a loaded pistol in each boot, but the crossbow was silent and accurate at longer range, and it wasted no precious powder. The guns were only for emergencies. Wingfield studied the dappled shadows. A little past noon, he guessed. Before long, he would have to turn round and head home for the colony. He had had a fairly good day. Two rabbits, several small birds, and a fat gray squirrel hung from his belt. He looked forward to fall and the harvest. If all went well this year, the colony would finally have enough wheat for bread and porridge and ale. How he wished, how all the Europeans wished, that this godforsaken new world offered wheat or barley or even oats of its own. But it did not, so all seed grain had to cross the Atlantic. Jamestown had lived mostly on game and roots for 3 years now. Lean and leathery, Wingfield had forgotten what a hot, fresh loaf tasted like. He remembered only that it was wonderful. Something stirred in the undergrowth ahead. He froze. The motion came again. He spied a fine, plump rabbit, its beady black eyes alert, its ears cocked for danger. Moving slowly and steadily, hardly breathing, he raised the crossbow to his shoulder, aimed down the bolt. Once the rabbit looked toward him, he stopped moving again until it turned its head away. He pressed the trigger. The bolt darted and slammed into a tree trunk a finger's breadth above the rabbit's ear. The beast bounded away. Hellfire! Wingfield dashed after it, yanking out one of his pistols. He almost tripped over the outflung branch of a grapevine. The vine's main stalk was as big around as his calf. Virginia grapes, and the rough wine the colonists made from them, were among the few things that helped keep Jamestown bearable. The panic-stricken rabbit, instead of diving into the bushes for cover and losing itself there, burst past a screen of brush into a clearing. "You lost mistake, beast," Wingfield cried in triumph. He crashed through the brush himself, swinging up the gun as he did so. By then the rabbit was almost to the other side of the clearing. He saw it thrashing in the grass there. Wingfield paused, puzzled. Had a ferret torn out its throat as it scampered along, oblivious to everything but its pursuer? Then his grip tightened on the trigger, for a sim emerged from a thicket and ran toward the rabbit. It had not seen him. It bent down by the writhing beast, smashed in the rabbit's head with a rock. Undoubtedly it had used another to bring the animal down. Sims were deadly accurate throwing sharpened stones. Wingfield stepped into the clearing. The colony was too hungry to let any food go. The sim heard him. It rose, clutching the bloody rock in a large, knobby, knuckled hand. It was about as tall as the Englishman, and naked but for its own abundant hair. Its long, chinless jaw opened to let out a hoot of dismay. Wingfield gestured with the pistol. Sims had no foreheads to speak of above their bone-ridged brows, but they had learned the colonists' weapons slew at a distance greater than they could cast their rocks. Usually these days they retreated instead of proving the lesson over again. This one, though, stood its ground, baring broad yellow teeth in a threatening grimace. Wingfield gestured again more sharply, and hoped he seemed more confident than he felt. If his first shot missed or even wounded but failed to kill, he would have to grab for his other gun while the sim charged, and pistol range was not that much more than a stone's throw. Then the bushes quivered on the far side of the clearing, and a second sim came out to stand behind its fellow. This one carried a large, sharp-edged rock ready to hurl. It shook its other fist at Wingfield and shouted angrily. It was the Englishman's turn to grind his teeth. If both Sims rushed him, he would never have the chance to reload either a pistol or his crossbow. The odds of stopping them with just two shots were not worth betting his life on, not for a rabbit. And if they did kill him, they would not content themselves with the game he carried. They would eat him, too. Raising the pistol in a final warning, he drew back into the woods. The Sims' mocking cries followed him. He hated the filthy animals, if they were animals. Close to a century had passed since the Spaniards brought the first pair back to Cadiz from their coastal fortress of Veracruz. Churchmen and scholars were still arguing furiously over whether Sims were mere brute beasts or human beings. At the moment, Wingfield was ready to hate them no matter what they were. He found the tree where he had shot at the rabbit the Sims were now doubtless gulping down raw. He managed to cut himself while he was digging out the crossbow bolt with his knife. That did nothing to improve his temper. Had he shot straight in the first place, he would not have put himself in the humiliating position of backing down from Sims. Thinking such dark thoughts, Wingfield turned back toward Jamestown. He scratched at his nose as he walked along and felt skin peel under his nails. One more annoyance. He was too fair not to burn in this climate, but found wearing a hat equally intolerable. On his way home, he knocked over a couple of quail and one of the native beasts that looked like giant white-faced rats, but tasted much better. That improved his mood, a little. He was still grumbling when Alan Cooper hailed him from the edge of the cleared ground. Thinking of the guard's misery made him ashamed of his own bad temper. Cooper wore a gleaming back and breast with thick padding beneath. A heavy plumed morion sat on his head. In that armor, he had to be steaming like a lobster boiled in its own shell. Yet he managed a cheery wave for Wingfield. "Good bag you have there," he called. "It should be better by one hair," Wingfield replied, peak flaring again. He explained how he had lost the beast to the Sims. "Aye, well, no help for such things sometimes. Not two on one. Cooper sighed, and Wingfield felt relief at having his judgment sustained by a professional soldier. The guard went on. "The thieving devils are robbing traps again, too. Henry Dale came in empty-handed this afternoon, swearing foul enough to damn himself on the spot." If swearing damns a man, Henry was smelling brimstone long years ere this, Wingfield observed. Cooper laughed. "You speak naught but the truth there, though I don't blame him for his fury this time. Sims are worse than foxes ever were. Foxes have no hands." He hefted his matchlock musket. "Without guns, we'd never keep them from our own animals. And how often have they raided the henhouse?" "Too many times." Wingfield turned to a less gloomy subject. "How is Cecil?"
"Doing splendidly," Cooper said, his voice full of pride. "The lad will be 3 months tomorrow."
Cecil Cooper was Jamestown's oldest child. The first ship carrying women had reached Virginia only a year before. Wingfield had a daughter, Joanna, only a few weeks younger than the guard's son. He left Cooper and walked down the muddy path through the fields. Several rows of thatch-roofed cabins stood by the log stockade that mounted cannon. On the other side of the fortress were longer rows of graves. More than half of the original 3 shiploads of colonists had died from starvation or disease. A couple of the newest burials were pathetically small. Even back in England, so many infants did not live to grow up, and life was far harsher here. But the marker that grieved Wingfield most was one of the oldest, the one showing where Captain John Smith lay. Always eager to explore, he had set about learning the countryside from the day the English landed, until the Sims killed him 3 months later. Without him, the settlement seemed to have a lesser sense of drive, of purpose. Still it went on, as people and their works do. Several colonists swung the gates of the fortress open, so others could drive in the pigs, goats, and oxen for the night to protect them from the Sims and other predators. The pigs and goats, which ate anything they came across, throve in this new land. The oxen had the same gaunt look as most of the colonists. Wingfield's cabin was in the outer row, closest to the forest. Smoke rose from the chimney as he approached. The door stood open to let in what air would come. Hearing her husband's step, Anne Wingfield came out to greet him. He hugged her close, so glad she had chosen to spend her life with him. She had had her pick of suitors, as was true of all the women in Virginia. Men outnumbered them 4-1. She exclaimed in pleasure at how much game he had brought home. Back in London, she would have been nothing special to look at, a rather husky, dark-haired girl in her early 20s with strong features, if anything, handsome rather than pretty. On this side of the Atlantic, though, she was by definition a beauty. "And how is Joanna?" Wingfield asked, as his wife skinned and disjointed his 2 rabbits and tossed the meat into the stewpot. The rabbits shared it with a small piece of stale venison from a couple of days before, and a mess of wild onions, beech nuts, mushrooms, and roots. The smell was heavenly. "Asleep now," Anne said, nodding toward the cradle. "But very well. She smiled at me again this morning." "Maybe next time she will do it in the night, so I may see it too. I hope she will." While they waited for the rabbits to cook, they dealt with the rest of Wingfield's catch, cutting the meat into thin strips and setting them on racks over the fire to dry and smoke. After what seemed an eternity, Anne ladled the stew into wooden bowls. Wingfield licked his clean. Though matters were not so grim as they had been the first couple of dreadful winters, he was always hungry. "I would have had another coney, but for the Sims," he said, and told Anne of the confrontation. Her hand jumped to her mouth. "Those horrid beasts! They should all be hunted down and slain, ere they harm any more of our good Englishmen. What would I have done here alone, save only for Joanna, had they hurt you?" "No need to fret over martyr beans. I'm here and hail," he reassured her, and got up and embraced her for good measure. "As for the Sims, if they be men, slaying them out of hand so would burden us with a great weight of sin when we are called to the Almighty." "They are no creatures of his," Anne returned, "but rather of the devil, the best he could do toward making true humankind.
I've heard that argument before. To me, it smacks of the Manichaean heresy. Only God has the power to create, not Satan.
Then why did he shape such vile parodies of ourselves, his finest creatures? The Sims know nothing of farming or weaving or any useful art. They cannot even set fires to cook the beasts they run down like dogs.
But they know fire, though I grant they cannot make it. Yet whenever lightning sets ablaze, some Sim will play Prometheus and seize a burning brand. They keep the flames alive as long as they may, till they lose them from rain or sheer fecklessness. Anne set hands on hips, gave Wingfield a dangerous look.
When last we hashed this over, as I recollect, 'twas you who reckoned the Sims animals, and I the contrary. Why this reversal?
Why yours? Save your concern for me. He came back.
I thank you for it, but the topic's fit to take from either side. I tell you frankly, I cannot riddle it out in certain, but am changeable as a weather vane, ever thinking now one thing, now the other.
And I, and everyone,
Anne sighed.
But if they put you in danger, my heart cannot believe them true men, no matter what my head might say.
He reached out to set his fingers gently on her arm. The tender gesture was spoilt when a mosquito spiraled down to land on the back of his hand. The swamps round Jamestown bred them in throngs worse than any he had known in England. He swatted at the bug, but it flew off before the death blow landed. Outside, someone struck up a tune on the mandolin, and someone else joined in with a drum. Voices soared in song. The settlers had only the amusements they could make for themselves. Wingfield looked out, saw a torchlit circle dance forming. He bobbed his head toward his wife.
Would it please you to join them?
Another time, she said. Joanna will be waking soon and hungry. We could step outside and watch, though.
Wingfield agreed at once. Any excuse to get out of the hot, smelly cabin was a good one. Suitors were buzzing as avidly as the mosquitoes round the few young women who had not yet chosen husbands. Some of those maids owned distinctly fragile reputations. With no others to choose from this side of the sea, they were courted nonetheless.
"Oh, my dear, what would you have me do?"
cried a roguish youngster named Caleb Lucas to a girl who, smiling, had turned her back on him.
"Go off to the woods and marry a Sim?"
Laughter rose, hearty from the men who heard him, half-horrified squeals from the women. Alan Cooper says the Spaniards do that, or anyway cohabit, Wingfield told Anne. Spain held a string of outposts down to Magellan's Strait and then up the western coast of South America to serve her galleons plying the rich trade with the Indies.
"Have they not read Deuteronomy?" Anne exclaimed, her lip curling in disgust.
Then curiosity got the better of her, and she whispered,
"Can there be issue from such unions?"
"In truth, I don't know. As Alan says, who's to tell the difference betwixt the get of a Spanish sire and that of a Sim?" Anne blinked, then burst into giggles at the bawdy slander against England's long-time foe. Before long, both she and her husband were yawning. The unremitting labor of building the colony left scant energy for leisure or anything else. Still, Wingfield hesitated before he blew out the last lamp in the cabin. He glanced toward Anne, and saw an answering flush rise from her throat to her cheeks. She was recovered now from the ordeal of childbirth. Perhaps tonight they might start a son. He was about to take Anne in his arms when Joanna let out a yowl. He stopped short. His wife started to laugh. She bared a breast.
"Let me feed her quickly and put her back to sleep. Then, why, we shall see what we shall see."
"Indeed we shall." Wingfield lay down on the lumpy straw-stuffed bed to wait. He knew at once he had made a mistake, but fell asleep before he could do anything about it. Anne stuck out her tongue at him when the sun woke him the next morning. She skipped back when he reached for her.
"This even," she promised. "We have too much to do of the day to waste it lying abed."
He grimaced.
"You have a hateful way of being right."
He scrambled into trousers and boots, set a plumed hat on his head to shield him from the sun.
The plume was a bright pheasant's feather from England, now sadly battered. Soon he would have to replace it with a duller turkey-tail feather. He was finishing a bowl of last night's stew, strong but still eatable, when someone knocked on the cabin door.
"There, you see," Anne said.
"Hush."
He opened the door. Henry Dale came in. He was a short, fussy man whose ruddy complexion and tightly held jaw gave clues to his temper. After dipping his head to Anne, he said,
"Edward, what say we set a few snares today? Mayhap if fortune favours us in spots where no knavish Sims will come on them to go a-poaching."
"Good enough. Alan Cooper told me how you were robbed yesterday."
Anne's presence plainly was the only thing keeping Dale from exploding with fury. He limited himself to a single strangled,
"Aye."
After a few moments, he went on.
"Shall we be about it, then?"
Wingfield checked his pistols, tucked a bundle of crossbow bolts into his belt pouch, nodded. After a too brief embrace with his wife, he followed Dale out into the bright morning. Colonists were already weeding, hoeing, watering in the fields. Caleb Lucas shooed a goat away from the fresh green stalks of wheat, speeding it on with a kick that brought an indignant bleat from the beast.
"And the very same to you," Lucas called after it.
"Damned impudent beast. You can find victuals anywhere, so why thieve your betters' meals?"
"Belike the foolish creature thinks itself a sim,"
Dale grunted, watching the goat scurry for the edge of the woods where it began browsing on shoots.
"It lacks the accursed losel's effrontery, though, for it will not turn on its natural masters. The Sims, now, those horse and beetle-headed flap-eared stinkards."
Without pausing but to draw breath, he continued in that vein until he and Wingfield were surrounded by forest. As had Anne's remarks the night before, his diatribe roused Wingfield's contentious nature.
"Were they such base animals as you claim?" he said.
"The Sims would long since have exterminated one another, and not been here for us to find on our landing." Dale gave him a look filled with dislike.
"For all we know, they well nigh did. 'Twas not on us they began their habits anthropophagous."
"If they were eating each other, Henry, and you style them anthropophagous, does that not make men of them?"
Wingfield asked mildly. His companion spluttered and turned even redder than usual. A robin twittered among the leaves. So the colonists named the bird at any rate, but it was not the redbreast of England. It was big and fat and stupid, its underparts the color of brick, not fire. It was, however, easy to kill, and quite tasty. There were other sounds in the woods, too. Somewhere far off, Wingfield heard the deep-throated barking cries of the Sims. So did Henry Dale. He spat deliberately between his feet.
"What men speak so?" he demanded. "Even captured and tamed, as much as one may tame the beasts, they do but point and gape and make a dumb show as a horse will, seeking to be led to manger."
"Those calls have meaning to them," Wingfield said.
"Oh, aye, belike. A wolf in a trap will howl so piteously it frightens its fellows away. Has he then a language?"
Having no good answer to that, Wingfield prudently kept silent. As the two men walked, they looked for signs to betray the presence of small game. Dale, who was an able woodsman when amiable, spotted the fresh droppings that told of a woodchuck run.
"A good place for a snare," he said.
But even as he was preparing to cut a noose, his comrade found a track in the soft ground to the side of the run, the mark of a large bare foot.
"Leave be, Henry," he advised. "The Sims have been here before us."
"What's that you say?"
Dale came over to look at the footprint. One of the settlers might have made it, but they habitually went shod. With a disgusted grunt, Dale stowed away the twine.
"Rot the bleeding blackguards! I'd wish their louse-ridden souls to hell did I think God granted them any."
"The Spaniards baptized them, 'tis said."
"Good on them!"
Dale said, which startled Wingfield until he continued.
"A papist baptism, by Jesus, is the most certain high road to hell of any I know."
They walked on. Wingfield munched on late-ripening wild strawberries, larger and sweeter than any that grew in England. He spotted a woodchuck ambling from tussock to tussock. This time he aimed with special care, and his shot knocked the beast over. Dale grunted again, now in approval. He had bagged nothing more than a couple of songbirds. They did find places to set several new snares, simple drag nooses, hanging snares made from slip nooses fastened to the ends of saplings, and fixed snares set near bushes. The latter were especially good for catching rabbits. They also visited the snares already set. A horrible stench announced that one of those had taken a black-and-white New World polecat. Skinned and butchered to remove the scent glands, the beast made good eating. Wingfield and Dale tossed a copper penny to see who would have to carry it home. Wingfield lost. Two traps had been sprung but held no game. There were fresh Sim footprints around both. Dale's remarks were colorful and inventive. The Englishmen headed back toward Jamestown not long after the sun began to wester. They took a route different from the one they had used on the way out. Several traps remained to be checked. A small brown and white striped ground squirrel scurried away from Wingfield's boot. It darted into a clump of cockleburrs. A moment later, both hunters leaped back in surprise as the little animal was flung head high, kicking in a noose, when a bent sapling suddenly sprang erect.
"Marry," Dale said. "I don't recall setting a snare there."
"Perhaps it was someone else. At all odds, good luck we happened along now."
Wingfield walked over to retrieve the ground squirrel, which now hung limp.
He frowned as he undid the noose from around its neck. "Who uses sinew for his traps?"
"No one I know," Dale said. "Twine is far easier to work with."
Wingfield was examining the way the sinew was bound to the top of the sapling. It had not been tied at all, only wrapped around and around several twigs until firmly in place.
"Have a look at this, will you, Henry?"
Dale looked, grunted, turned away. Wingfield's voice pursued him.
"What animals make traps, Henry?"
"Ay, well, this is the first we've seen in all the time we've been this side of the Atlantic. I take that to mean the Sims but ape us, as a jackdaw will human speech, without having the divine spark of wit to devise any such thing for themselves. Damn and blast, man! If a dog learns to walk upon his hinder feet, is he then deserving of a seat in Parliament?"
"More than some who have them now," Wingfield observed.
Both men laughed. Dale reached for the ground squirrel, tossed it into the bag with the rest of the game he carried. His crooked teeth flashed in a rare grin.
"It does my heart good to rob the vermin this once, instead of the other way round."
His good humor vanished when he and Wingfield returned to the settlement. They found not only Alan Cooper and the other three guards armed and armored, but also a double handful more men. That morning a Sim had burst out of the woods, smashed in a goat's skull with a rock, flung the animal under an arm and escaped, before the startled Englishman could do anything.
"I shot, but I missed," Cooper said morosely.
"It's a poor trade for a ground squirrel, Henry," Wingfield remarked.
His hunting partner's scowl was midnight black.
"The mangy pests grow too bold. Just the other night they slaughtered a hound outside the stockade, hacked it to pieces with their stones, and were eating the flesh raw when at last the sentry came round with his torch and spied them."
"He missed too,"
Dale finished, with a sidelong look at Cooper.
"And would you care to draw a conclusion from that?"
the guard asked. His hand caressed the hilt of his rapier. Henry Dale hesitated. As a gentleman, he was trained to the sword, but liverish temper or no, he was not a fool. Cooper had learned in a harsher school than his and survived. At last, Dale said,
"I draw the same conclusion as would any man of sense, that our best course is to rid ourselves of these pestiferous Sims forthwith, as wolves and other vicious creatures have long been hunted out of England."
"I hold to war, Henry, on being attacked, but not to murder," Cooper said. "Mind, we must seem as outlandish to them as they to us."
"Killing a Sim is no more murder than butchering a pig," Dale retorted.
The endless debate started up again. Having no desire to join in another round, Wingfield took his share of the game back to his cabin. Anne was changing Joanna's soiled linen.
She looked up with a wan smile. There's no end to it.
The baby kicked her legs and smiled toothlessly at her father. He felt his own tight expression soften. He plucked the songbirds, skinned the polecat, set the hide aside to be tanned. He gutted the birds and tossed their little naked bodies into the stewpot hole. He threw the offal outside for the pigs or dogs to find. The black and white polecat required more skillful butchery, for it had to be cut into pieces after the scent glands were removed.
Thank you, dear.
Anne rocked Joanna in her arms.
She's getting hungry, aren't you, sweet one? What say I feed you now, so you let us eat in peace afterwards? Can you tend to the stew, Edward?
Of course.
He stirred the bubbling contents of the pot with a wooden spoon. Now and again he tossed in a dash of dried powdered herbs or a pinch of greyish sea salt. Joanna nursed lustily, then fell asleep. The stew began to smell savory. Anne was about to ladle it into bowls when the baby wet herself and started crying again. Her mother gave Wingfield a look of mingled amusement and despair.
Go on with what you were about, he told her. I'll tend to Joanna.
Anne sighed gratefully. Wingfield tossed the soggy linen into the pile with the rest for tomorrow's washing. He found a dry cloth, wrapped the baby's loins, and set her in her cradle. Anne rocked it while they ate. Joanna tolerated not being held, but showed no interest in going back to sleep. She squawked indignantly when Anne made the mistake of trying to turn her onto her belly, and remained irritated enough to stay awake even after her mother picked her up. Her fussy cries rang loud in the small cabin. After a while, Wingfield thrust a torch into the fire.
Let's walk her about outside, he suggested. That often seems to calm her.
Anne agreed at once. She rocked the baby in her arms while her husband held the torch high so they would not stumble in the darkness. With his free hand, he batted at the insects the torch drew. The James River splashed against the low swampy peninsula on which Jamestown sat, and murmured as it flowed by unimpeded to the south. Above it, on this clear, moonless night, the Milky Way glowed like pale mist among the stars of the Scorpion and the Archer. Elsewhere, but for silver points, the sky was black. Even blacker against it loomed the forest to the north. Suddenly Wingfield felt how tiny was the circle of light his torch cast, as tiny as the mark the English had made on this vast new land. The comparison disturbed him. From the edge of the forest came the cries of Sims, calling back and forth. Wingfield wondered how much meaning lay behind them.
Those bestial ululations could hardly be true speech. Henry Dale was right there. But they were much more varied, more complex than a wolf pack's howls.
Anne shivered, though the night was warm.
Let us go back. I take fright hearing them so close.
I mislike it also, Wingfield said, turning round. We're not yet here in numbers enough to keep them from drawing nigh as they wish. Be glad, though, you were still in dear England those first 2 years, when they thought us and ours some new sort of prey for their hunting.
He touched the knife on his belt.
We've taught them better than that, at any rate.
I've heard the tales, Anne said quietly.
Wingfield nodded. As was the way of things, though, not all the tales got told. He had been one of the men who brought John Smith's body back for burial. He knew how little of it rested under its stone, awaiting the resurrection. To his mind, the Sims' man-eating habits gave strong cause to doubt they had souls. If one man devoured another's flesh, to whose body would that flesh return come the day of judgment? As far as he knew, no learned divine had yet solved that riddle. Such profitless musings occupied him on the way back to the cabin. Once inside, Anne set Joanna back in the cradle. The baby sighed but stayed asleep. She probably would not rouse till the small hours of the morning. The embers in the fireplace cast a dying red glow over the single room. Wingfield stripped off his clothes. In the sultry Virginia summer, nightwear was a positive nuisance. Anne lay down beside him. He stroked her smooth shoulder. She turned toward him. His eyes were enormous in the dim light.
Here it is, evening, he said,
at the same time as she was whispering,
this even, is it not?"
They laughed until he silenced her with a kiss.
Afterwards, he felt his heart slow as he drifted toward slumber. He was hotter than he had been before, and did not mind at all. The warmth of the body was very different from that of the weather. He did not know why that was so, but it was. Anne was already breathing deeply and smoothly. He gave up thought and joined her.
He was never sure what exactly woke him some hours later. He usually slept like a log till morning. Even Joanna's cries would not stir him, though Anne came out of bed at once for them. And this noise was far softer than any the baby made. Maybe what roused him was the breeze from the open cabin door. His eyes opened. His hand went for his knife even before he consciously saw the two figures silhouetted in the doorway. Thieves, was his first thought. The colonists had so few goods from England that theft was always a problem, the threat of the whipping post notwithstanding. Then the breeze brought him the smell of the invaders. The Englishmen bathed seldom, they were often rank, but this was a thicker, almost cloying stench, as if skin and water had never made acquaintance. And the shape of those heads outlined against the night. Ice ran through Wingfield.
"Sims!" he cried, bounding to his feet.
Anne screamed. The Sims shouted. One sprang at Wingfield. He saw its arm go back as if to stab, and knew it must have one of its sharpened stones to hand. That could let out a life as easily as his own dagger. He knocked the stroke aside with his left forearm and felt his hand go numb. The Sims were devilish strong. He thrust with his right and felt his blade bite flesh. The Sim yammered, but the wound was not mortal. The Sim grappled with him. They rolled over and over on the dirt floor, each grabbing for the other's weapon and using every fighting trick he knew. The Sim might have had less skill than Wingfield, but was physically powerful enough to make up for it. A tiny corner of Wingfield's awareness noticed the other Sim scuttling toward the hearth. He heard Anne shriek, "Mother Mary, the baby!" Bold as a tigress, she leapt at the Sim, her hands clawed, but it stretched her senseless with a backhand blow. At almost the same moment, the Sim Wingfield was battling tore its right arm free from the weakened grasp of his left. He could not ward off the blow it aimed, but partially deflected it, so that the flat front of the stone, rather than the edge, met his forehead. The world flared for a moment, then grayed over. He could not have been unconscious long. He was already aware of himself, and of the pounding anguish in his head, when someone forced a brandy bottle into his mouth. He choked and sputtered, spraying out most of the fiery liquid. He tried to sit. Hands supported his back and shoulders. He could not understand why the torch Caleb Lucas held was so blurred until he raised his arm to his eyes and wiped away blood. Lucas offered the brandy again. This time Wingfield got it down. Healing warmth spread from his middle. Then he remembered what had happened with one Sim while he fought the other, and he went cold again.
"Anne!"
he cried. He looked about wildly and moaned when he saw a blanket-covered form on the floor not far from him.
"No, fear not, Edward. She is but stunned," said Alan Cooper's wife, Claire, a strong, steady woman a few years older than Anne. "We cast the bedding over her to hide her nakedness, no more."
"Oh, God be thanked," Wingfield gasped.
"But," Cooper began, then looked helplessly at his wife, not sure how to go on. He seemed to make up his mind. He and Lucas bent by Wingfield. Together they manhandled Wingfield to his feet, guided his stumbling steps over to Joanna's cradle. He moaned again. It was empty. Anne sat on a hard wooden chair, her face buried in her hands. She had not stopped sobbing since she returned to her senses. She rocked back and forth in unending grief.
"God, God, God, have mercy on my dear Joanna," she wailed.
"I will get her back," Wingfield said, "or take such a vengeance that no Sim shall dare venture within miles of an Englishman ever again."
"I want no vengeance," Anne cried. "I want my darling babe again."
The colonists' first efforts at pursuit had already failed. They had set dogs on the Sims trail less than an hour after the attack. With the blood Wingfield had drawn, the trail had been fresh and clear. Only for a while, though. The ground north of Jamestown was so full of ponds and streams that the dogs lost the scent. Further tracking had had to wait for daylight, and with every passing minute, the Sims took themselves farther away.
"Why?"
Anne asked. The question was not directed at anyone.
"Why should even such heartless brutes snatch up a defenseless babe? What are they doing to her?"
Wingfield's imagination conjured up a horde of possibilities, each worse than the one before. He knew he could never mention even the least of them to his wife. But her first agonized question puzzled him as well. He had never heard of the Sims acting as they had that night. They killed, but they did not capture. He felt heartsick anew as he worked out the implications of that. Caleb Lucas said,
"I fear me they but sought specially tender flesh."
He spoke softly so Anne would not hear. Wingfield shook his head. The motion hurt. "Why take so great a risk for such small game?" He gritted his teeth at speaking of Joanna so, but went on. "They would have gained more meat by waiting until one of us stepped outside his cabin to ease himself, striking him down and making away with him. If they had been cunning, they might have escaped notice till dawn."
"Wherefore, then?"
Lucas asked. Wingfield could only spread his hands.
"What do you purpose doing now?"
Alan Cooper added.
"As I told Anne," Wingfield said, rising. His head still throbbed dreadfully, and he was wobbly on his feet, but purpose gave his voice iron. "I will search out the places where the Sims encamp in their wanderings and look for traces of Joanna. If, God grant, I find her living, I'll undertake a rescue. If it be otherwise..."
Henry Dale stuck his head in the cabin door, his lips stretched back in a savage grin.
"Then kill them all," he finished for Wingfield. "'Twere best you do it anyhow at first encounter."
"No," Wingfield said, "nor anyone else on my behalf, I pray you. Until I have certain knowledge my daughter is dead, I needs must act as if she yet lives and do nothing to jeopardize her fate. A wholesale slaughter of Sims might well inflame them all. What cares one pack of beasts what befalls another?" Dale asked scornfully.
Alan Cooper had a comment more to the point.
"Should you fare forth alone, Edward, I greatly doubt you'd work a wholesale slaughter in any case. More likely, the Sims would slay you."
That set off fresh paroxysms of weeping from Anne. Wingfield looked daggers at the guard.
"I can but do my best. My hunting has taught me somewhat of woodscraft, and bullet and bolt strike harder and farther than stones."
He spoke mostly for his wife's benefit. He knew too well Cooper was probably right. Still, he went on.
"You'd try no less were it your Cecil."
"Oh, aye, so I would," Cooper said. "You misunderstand me, though. My thought was to come with you."
"And I,"
Henry Dale said. Caleb Lucas echoed him a moment later. Tears stung Wingfield's eyes. Anne leapt from her chair and kissed each of his friends in turn. At any other time, that would have shocked and angered him. Now he thought it no less than their due. Yet fear for his daughter forced expedience from him. He said, "Henry, I know your skill amongst the trees, but what of you, Alan? Stealth is paramount here, and clanking about armoured a poor preparation for it."
"Fear not on my score," Cooper said. "Or ever I took the royal shilling, I had some nodding acquaintance with the Crown's estates and the game on them."
He grinned slyly. Wingfield asked no more questions. If Cooper had made his living poaching, he would never say so straight out.
"What'll the council say, though, Alan?"
Dale demanded.
"They will not take kindly to a guardsman herring off at wild adventure." "Then damnation take them," Cooper replied. "Am I not a free Englishman, able to do as I will rather than hark to seven carping fools? Every subject's duty is the king's, but every subject's soul is his own."
"Well spoken. Imitate the action of the tiger,"
cried Caleb Lucas, giving back one quote from Shakespeare for another. The other three men were carefully studying him. Wingfield said,
"You will correct me if I'm wrong, Caleb, but it's not so your only forays into the forest have been as a lumberer?"
The young man gave a reluctant nod. He opened his mouth to speak, but Dale forestalled him.
"Then you must stay behind. Edward has reason in judging this a task for none but the woods wise."
Wingfield set a hand on Lucas's shoulder. "No sense in anger or disappointment, Caleb. I know the offer came in all sincerity."
"And I,"
Anne echoed softly. Lucas jerked his head in acknowledgement and left.
"Let's be at it, then," Cooper said. "To our weapons, then meet here and away."
Wingfield knew the guard had no hope of finding Joanna alive when he heard Cooper warn Henry Dale. "Fetch plenty of powder and bullets." Dale's brusque nod said the same. Before noon, the three men reached the spot where the dogs had lost the Sims' scent. As Wingfield had known it would, the trail led through the marshes that made up so much of the peninsula on which Jamestown lay. By unspoken consent, he and his companions paused to rest and to scrape at the mud clinging to their boots. His crossbow at the ready, Wingfield looked back the way he had come, then to either side. For some time now he had had a prickly feeling of being watched, though he told himself a Sim would have to be mad to go so near the English settlement after the outrage of the night before. But Cooper and Dale also seemed uneasy. The guard rubbed his chin, saying,
"I like this not. I'm all a jitter, as I've not felt since the poxy Spaniards snuck a patrol round our flank in Holland." "We'd best push on," Henry Dale said. "We'll cast about upstream and down in hopes of picking up tracks again. Were things otherwise, I'd urge us separate, one going one way and two the other to speed the search. Now," he bared his teeth in frustration, "'twere better we stayed in a body."
The bushes quivered about 15 paces away. Three weapons swung up as one. But instead of a Sim bursting from the undergrowth, out came Caleb Lucas.
"You young idjit! We might have shot you," Cooper snarled.
His finger was tight on the trigger of his pistol. As a veteran soldier, he always favored firearms. Lucas was even filthier than the men he faced. His grin flashed in his mud-spattered face.
"Send me back, no, if you dare, my good sirs. These past 2 hours I've dogged your steps, betimes close enough to spit, and never did you tumble to it. Have I not, then, sufficient of the woodsman's art to accompany you farther?"
Wingfield removed the bolt from his bow, released the string.
"I own myself beaten, Caleb, for how should we say you nay? The damsels back in town, though, will take your leaving hard.
They'll have plenty to company them whilst I'm gone, and shall be there on my return," Lucas said cheerfully. "And in sooth, Edward, are we not off to rescue a fair young damsel of our own? Not wondrous fair, perhaps, since the little lass favours me, but I take your meaning," Wingfield considered. "We'll do as Henry proposed before your eruption and divide to examine the stream bank. Caleb, you'll come with me this way. Henry and Alan shall take the other. Half a mile either way, then back here to meet. A pistol shot to signal a find. Otherwise we go on as best we can, agreed?"
Everyone nodded. A sergeant to the core, Cooper muttered, "As well I don't have Caleb with me. I want a man and I'll do as he's told."
Unabashed, Lucas came to such a rigid parody of attention that the others could not help laughing. He and Wingfield hurried along the edge of the creek, their heads down. Herons and white-plumed egrets flapped away. Frogs and turtles splashed into the turbid water.
"There,"
Lucas said, his finger stabbed forth. The print of a bare foot was pressed deeply into the mud.
"Good on you."
Wingfield clapped him on the back, drew out one pistol and fired it into the air. He reloaded in the few minutes before Dale and Cooper came trotting up. Dale, who was red as a tile, grunted when he spied the footprint.
"The brutes did not slip far enough aside, eh, my hearties? Well, after them."
The trail ran northwest, almost paralleling the James River, but moving slowly away. It became harder to follow as the ground grew drier. and the effort of sticking to it meant the four trackers had to go more slowly than the Sims they pursued. By evening, the Englishmen were beyond the territory they knew well. Explorers had penetrated much farther into the interior of America, of course, but not all of them had come back, and with the colony's survival hanging by so slender a thread, exploration for its own sake won scant encouragement. At last the thickening twilight made Wingfield stop.
"We'll soon lose the trace," he said, smacking fist into palm. "Yet I misdoubt the Sims push on still. What to do, what to do?"
Again Caleb Lucas came to the rescue.
"Look there, between the two pines. Is not a pillar of smoke, mayhap marking one of the Sims' nests?"
"Marry, it is."
Wingfield turned to Alan Cooper, the most experienced of them at such estimations.
"How far away do you make it?"
The guard's eyes narrowed as he thought.
"The Sims favor large blazes, as being less likely to go out. Perhaps 2-2.5 miles. Too far to reach before full dark."
"All the better," Dale said. "I'd liefer come on the accursed creatures with them unawares."
No one cared to disagree. Cooper took the lead as they grew closer.
"Reminds me of a scouting party I commanded outside Harlem," he remarked, and reminisced in quiet tones until they drew within a few hundred yards of the fire.
He stopped then and waved the others to a halt behind him.
"Let me go on alone a bit," he whispered. "If they're as smart as Spaniards, which says not much, they're apt to have a sentry out, and I'll need to scout away past it."
He slipped away before Henry Dale could voice the protest he was plainly forming. Whether a poacher or not, Cooper had told the truth. He could move silently in the woods. It was too dark to see his face when he reappeared, but his whisper was smug.
"The booger's there, just so. Here, hands and knees now after me, and he'll never be the wiser."
"That was so in any case," Dale retorted.
But he lowered himself with the others. Again Wingfield caught the thick, warm stench from the Sim. It never sensed him or his comrades who crawled past downwind, another proof Cooper knew his business. The Englishman peered through a last thin screen of bushes at the band of Sims. Perhaps 25 were there. Several slept close to the fire. From time to time a grizzled male threw a fresh branch onto it. The Sim would let it get low, but never close to going out. Along with the odors of smoke and Sim, the air still held the faint flavor of roasted, or rather burnt, meat. Bones from small game lay about. Every so often a Sim would pick one up and gnaw on it. The Sims ate anything. A female turned over stones and popped the grubs and crawling things it found into its mouth, or handed them to the toddling youngster beside it. The firekeeper grabbed moths out of the air with practiced skill, crunching them between its teeth. Another younger male was using a hammer made from a piece of antler to chip flakes from a rock it held between its knees. Wingfield studied the Sims with growing disappointment. None bore a knife wound, and he saw no sign of Joanna. The three or four infants in the band all bore a finer coat of the dark brown hair that covered their elders. One was nursing at its mother's breast and fell asleep in its arms. The female Sim set it down on a pile of leaves. It woke up and started to yowl. The mother picked it up and rocked it till it was quiet again. Alan Cooper let out the ghost of a chuckle.
"Looks familiar, that."
"Aye,"
Wingfield whispered back.
"We may as well be off. We've not found here what we sought."
To his surprise, Henry Dale said,
"Wait!"
He had been watching a pair of Sims grooming each other, hands scurrying through hair after ticks, fleas, and lice. The scratchings and pickings had gradually turned to caresses and nuzzlings. Then the Sims coupled by the fire like dogs, the male behind the female. The rest of the band paid no attention.
"Shameless animals,"
Dale muttered, but he watched avidly until they were through. He was, Wingfield recalled, unwed, and with his temper had enjoyed no luck among the single women at the settlement. Unslaked lust could drive a man to madness. Wingfield remembered the sinful longing with which his own eyes had followed a pretty cabin boy aboard the Godspeed. But even if sure the prohibitions in Deuteronomy did not apply, he would have let sim females alone forever, no matter what vile rumor said Spaniards did. One could close one's eyes to the ugliness, hold one's nose against the stench, but how in an embrace could one keep from noticing the hair? The sound of the edge of a hand striking a wrist and a harsh whispered curse snapped Wingfield from his lascivious reverie.
"Be damned to you right back, Henry," Caleb Lucas said hotly. "Edward said no killings whilst his daughter remained stolen, and if you come to his aid, you can do his bidding."
Dale picked up his pistol, which by good luck had fallen on soft grass and neither made a betraying noise nor discharged.
"The filthy creatures all deserve to die," he growled,
barely bothering to hold his voice low. His face was pitiless as a wolf's. Wingfield abruptly realized Dale had never expected to find Joanna alive, but was along only for revenge. If, by some stroke of fortune, they should come across the baby, his comrade might prove more dangerous to her than the Sims. All he said, though, was,
"My thanks, Caleb. Anyway now, quiet as we can. Come morning, we'll hash out what to do next."
Cooper led them away from the Sims by the same route they had taken in. Again they passed by the lone watcher close enough to catch its reek. They camped without fire, which would have brought Sims at a run. After gnawing leathery smoked meat, they divided the night into four watches and seized what uncomfortable, bug-ridden sleep they could. When morning came, they took counsel.
"It makes no sense," Henry Dale complained. "Where was the sim you fought, Edward? None of the beasts round their blaze showed the knife mark you said you set in him."
"I thought the same, and again found myself without answer," Wingfield said. If Dale was willing to let last night's quarrel lie, he did not intend to bring it up himself.
"Hold, I have a thought," Caleb Lucas said. Somehow he managed to seem fresh on scanty rest. "When we spied the Sims' fire, we heard straight for it, and gave no more heed to the track we'd followed.
Could we pick it up once more?"
"The very thing," Alan Cooper exclaimed. "'Sblood, we're stupider than the Sims, for we acted on what we thought they'd done when the truth was laid out before us. Had we only the wit to look on it?"
"Shorn of the windy philosophizing, the point is well taken," Dale said.
Before Cooper had time to get angry, Wingfield said hastily, "Could you find the spot where we saw the smoke, Alan?"
"Maybe His Royal Highness there would sooner lead us," the guard snapped.
Dale opened his mouth to reply, but Wingfield glared at him so fiercely that he shut it again. At length, Cooper said,
"Yes, I expect I can."
He proved as good as his word, though the trip was necessarily slow and cautious to avoid foraging Sims. When the Englishmen returned to the place by the two pines, they cast about for the trace they had pursued the day before. Cooper found it first, and could not help sending a look of satisfaction at Henry Dale's back before he summoned his companions. They eagerly followed the track, which to their growing confusion ran in the same direction they had previously chosen.
"Cooper, we've already seen the brutes did not come this way," Dale said with an ominously false show of patience.
"No, all we've seen is that they did not reach the band. Tracks have no flair for lying."
Cooper held his course. Dale, fuming, had no choice but to follow. A few minutes later, the guard stiffened.
"Look here, all of you. Of a sudden, they spun on their heels and headed northeast."
"Why, I wonder," Wingfield said.
He glanced toward the column of smoke from the Sims' fire, pointed.
"They could easily see that from here."
"What does it matter?"
That was Henry Dale.
"Let's hunt down the beasts and have done with this pointless chatter."
"Pointless it is not," Wingfield said, "if it will help us in the hunting. Were you coming to a camp of your friends, Henry? Why would you then avoid it?"
"Who knows why a Sim does as it does, or cares? If it amuses you to enter the mind of an animal, go on, but ask me not to partake of your fatuity."
"Hold, Henry," Cooper said.
Edward's query is deserving of an answer. In war now, I'd steer clear of a camp. Did it contain the enemy?
Are Simban's nations writ in small?
Dale scoffed. I tell you honestly, I do not know for a fact, Cooper replied. Nor, Henry, do you. Dale scowled. Cooper stared him down. The country rose as they travelled away from the James. The Sims they were following stuck to wooded and brushy areas, even when that meant deviating from their chosen course. After seeing the fourth or fifth such zigzag, Cooper grunted,
Nation or no, that pair didn't relish being spotted. Soldiers travel so behind the foe's lines.
Even if you have reason, Caleb Lucas said a while later, ruefully rubbing at the thorn scratches on his arms,
why did the wretched creatures have to traverse every patch of brambles they could find?
Not for the sake of hearing your whining, surely.
Had Cooper given Henry Dale that rebuke, he would have growled it. With the irrepressible young Lucas, he could not keep a twinkle from his eyes. All the Englishmen were scratched and bleeding. Wingfield stopped to extract a briar that had pierced his breeches. The bushes around him were especially thick and thorny, their leaves a glistening, venomous green. Only against that background would the white bit of cloth have caught his notice. He reached out and plucked it from its bramble without realizing for a moment what it meant. Then he let out a whoop that horrified his comrades. They stared at him as a madman while he held up the tiny piece of linen.
From Joanna's shift,
he said when he had calmed enough to speak clearly again.
It must be.
The Sims know nothing of fabric, nor even pelts to cover their loins.
Save their own pelts, that is,
Lucas grinned. Then the excitement took him too.
Proof we're on the right track.
And proof, or at least hope, my little girl yet lives,
Wingfield said as much to himself as to the rest. Had the Sims sought no more than meat, they'd not have left the shift round her so long, would they? He looked to the others for reassurance.
It were unlikely, Edward, Cooper said gently.
Caleb Lucas nodded. Henry Dale said nothing. Wiping his florid face with his sleeve, he pushed ahead.
Late that afternoon, near the edge of a creek, the Englishman came upon the scaly tail of a muskrat. All that was left of the beast.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.